Hello, good evening everyone, and welcome to our final session of the day. Welcome from on behalf of the Rohini Nilekani Philanthropies. So on this session we have three really interesting and lovely guests with us. I'll quickly set the context, lay out some housekeeping for the session, introduce our guests, and then we can move forward. So the line dividing the professional creed of a journalist from her anxieties as a citizen is getting blurred. How do they view journalism pushing citizens towards being informed, empathetic, invested citizens with a unified intent of a strong society? How do they view the evolving role of media in these times of unprecedented change? And this is sort these are sort of the questions that we're trying to explore through this session. We have Dhanya from we have Dhanya, who's editor-in-chief of the digital portal, The News Minute, that brings in-depth and incisive reports from South India. She's also the chairperson of DigiPub, India's biggest association of digital media publishers. We have Meera Devi with us as well. She is bureau chief editor at Khabar Lehriya, the country's only woman-run brand of ethical and independent rural news. With 14 years of reporting on rural issues, Meera Devi specializes in investigative journalism and policy reporting. Finally, we have Barkha Dutt with us as well, who will be driving this session forward. She's an Indian television journalist, author, and owner of the YouTube news channel Mojo Story. She's an opinion columnist with the Hindustan Times and the Washington Post. Barkha has won many national and international awards, including the Padma Shri. And so before wasting any more time, I would like to hand it over to Barkha. And just a few housekeeping rules before that. We are hoping to run the session for about 50 minutes. And then we have a chat and a Q&A box on the right-hand side for the audience. We encourage you to use the chat box for general commentary during the session, and we encourage you to use your Q&A box to pop up any questions that you want. In the last 10 minutes of the session, we will try to take some questions if time permits. Barkha and all the other guests, thank you so much for being here. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Yash, and welcome to Dhanya and Meera ji. You know, we're here to talk about the blurring lines between us as citizens and us as journalists. And is it a good thing that those lines are actually blurring? In Hindi, I am fond of saying, and I'll translate into English, that today's media is fast becoming either chamcha ya morcha, which means either supplicants or activists. Is that a good thing for people like me who are old and old-fashioned both? I tend to believe that your story and your work must speak, not you know, that you go into a morcha somewhere or you go into a dharna somewhere. But there are also generational shifts in some of those assumptions. Now, what's very interesting about both our guests today, and main thoda Hindi English mix rakhungi, if that's okay with everybody. So I'll be, you know, between the two languages for the comfort of both our panelists and our audience. आजकल जो इंटरेस्टिंग चीज है वो ये है कि बहुत से पत्रकार समझते हैं कि उनका जो रोल है वो पत्रकारिता ही नहीं समाज को बदलना है, और क्या वो समाज को अपनी पत्रकारिता के जरिए बदलना चाहते हैं कि वो खुद भी एक तरह से एक्टिविस्ट का रोल डॉन करते हुए बदलना चाहते हैं. शुड जर्नलिस्ट बी एक्टिविस्ट, और शुड वी मेक श्योर दैट वॉइसेस फ्रॉम द ग्रास रूट्स, फ्रॉम द मार्जिनलाइज कम्युनिटीज, थ्रू आर वर्क ड्राइव दैट चेंज. सो लेट मी स्टार्ट विद यू धन्या. News Minute has a distinct approach, and that approach is to pick up something that used to be underrepresented in the national media, because the national mainstream media used to be essentially Delhi media, and it never used to cover the South. Now, two things that News Minute does, which I really like: one, it is reporting driven, and two, it is very specific that we are covering the South. Meera ji, मैं ये कह रही हूँ कि धनिया जी की जो वेबसाइट है वो साउथ सदर्न स्टेट्स पे फोकस्ड है और रिपोर्टिंग पर बहुत ज्यादा जोर देती है. धनिया, गो अहेड.
So both these things were of course planned out, in the sense, as you said, I was part of the national media for many years doing television. And I realized, I mean, for many years I was one of those people who kept saying the nation wants to know. And then suddenly I realized the nation doesn't want to know. I mean, this is what I tell everyone. So when I made the realization, the choice before me was to again do the same thing or to try something different. Now, the reason why it is important to tell stories from all parts of India is because I believe the national media stopped being real national media a long time ago. They are basically Delhi, Bombay-centric media with a little bit interest in other, there's no sustained interest in any of the other areas or topics. So one was an area-specific interest, which I thought the news minute should put forward. And the second is basically, I was very clear that I had to unlearn a lot of stuff, which I learned from television. And during one of those unlearnings, I also realized that if I have an organization, it has to be a feminist organization. By feminist, I don't mean an organization which simply looks at misogyny or patriarchy in society, but you write consistently about issues of women, whether it's from education to all kinds of things. So these are the two interests which the News Minute has.
Okay. मीरा जी, आप लोगों का जो प्लेटफॉर्म है खबर लहरिया, वो और भी डिस्टिंक्ट है. इट इज इवन मोर डिस्टिंक्ट बिकॉज इट इज वुमेन लेड एंड वुमेन फोकस्ड. आप औरतें हैं जो इस इनिशिएटिव को लीड करती हैं, बहुत साल से कर रही हैं. आप कैसे अपना रोल देखती हैं? आपको क्या लगता है एक पत्रकार का रोल समाज में क्या है? क्या आपका रोल है कि आपने रिपोर्टिंग की, आपने स्टोरी बिना किसी डर, बिना किसी बायस के लोगों के सामने रखी, और फिर लोगों के ऊपर है कि वो उस स्टोरी के बेसिस पे कुछ बदले या नहीं? कि क्या आपको लगता है कि आपकी ड्यूटी समाज को बदलना, राजनीति को बदलना है?
मुझे लगता है कि जहाँ तक पत्रकारिता और हमारी रिपोर्टिंग और मेरी जो रिपोर्टिंग का अनुभव रहा है, ये कि मतलब कि जो भी मुद्दे हैं और उन पर जब जिनके लिए जिन जिन स्थानों पे हम गए हैं, जिन लोगों के लिए हम गए हैं, उस आवाज़ को निकाल कर लाना, वहाँ की जो जो दबी हुई आवाज़ें हैं, जिनको कभी जगह नहीं दी जाती है, कभी माना नहीं जाता कि वो भी मुद्दे होते हैं, मीडिया के मुद्दे होते हैं, वो उन जगहों को, उन आवाज़ों को, उन उन मुद्दों को उठाना और फिर जवाबदेही के तौर पर प्रशासन से मिलना और फिर सरकार पर सवाल उठाना. तो मतलब ये एक लोकतंत्र के नज़रिए से हम देखते हैं कि जनता का हक क्या है. ये जो हम बार बार, हमारे संविधान में भी ये लिखा गया, कहा गया है और लिखा है कि लोकतंत्र, मीडिया की जो भूमिका है वो लोकतंत्र से बहुत जुड़ती है और हम उसी आधार से, उसी को देखते हैं, लोकतंत्र के आधार से ही अपनी रिपोर्टिंग को देखते हैं.
मैं आपसे एक चीज पूछना चाहती हूँ. जैसे हम लोगों पर काफी प्रेशर रहता है, चाहे हम टीवी में हो, चाहे हम डिजिटल में हो, चाहे हम अखबार में हो, हम लोगों पर, मीरा जी, काफी प्रेशर रहता है कि कितने लोग हमें पढ़ रहे हैं या कितने लोग हमें देख रहे हैं. और जब हमारे ऑडियंस छोटी होती है तो हमें घबराहट सी होती है और हमारे ऊपर प्रेशर भी डलता है. कभी एडवर्टाइजर्स का प्रेशर डलता है, कभी हमारे बॉसेस का. मैं सिर्फ अभी धनिया और मेरी बात नहीं कर रही, मैं एक जनरल बात कर रही हूँ. तो क्या आपके ऊपर भी ये दबाव है कि ऑडियंस साइज या रीडर्स एक स्टोरी के लिए नहीं आए तो आपको लगता है कि ये फिर ये मुद्दा छोड़ देते हैं क्योंकि इसके लिए बड़ी ऑडियंस नहीं है?
नहीं, ऐसा हमें नहीं लगा हुआ. हमें तो लगा हुआ ना कि जो 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 मतलब जितना छोटा मुद्दा है, जिसके लिए लोग बहुत कम देख रहे हैं, उसी मुद्दे को तो हमें लाना है. वही हमारा मकसद है, उसी मुद्दे को ऊपर उठाना है ताकि जो एक छोटी सी एक जगह है उसको बड़े नजरिए से देखें लोग, चाहे वो सरकार हो, चाहे आम लोग हो, चाहे जो एक्टिव बिस्ट हूँ, सामाजिक लोग, सामाजिक कार्यकर्ता जो अपने को एक तरह का समाज को बदलने का ठेकेदारी लेके रखा है, उन सब की नज़र इन जगहों पर जरूर जाना चाहिए और हम जबरदस्ती उनकी नज़र वहाँ पे ले जाना ही चाहते हैं. इसलिए वही हमारे लिए बहुत पावर है.
आपने बहुत जरूरी बात की है और मैं इसको अंग्रेजी में इसका थोड़ा ट्रांसलेशन करना चाहती हूँ. मीरा हैज जस्ट सेड that she believes that the exact issues that don't have mass interest, mass following automatically, are the ones that need to be highlighted more. Dhanya, that used to be something that we, thank you, that used to be something that we used to think, we used to believe, that our job was A, to jolt people out of their comfort and also to sort of talk about things that weren't necessarily popular, right? But frankly, the tyranny of advertising, the tyranny of the revenue model, the tyranny of the algorithm, the tyranny of the state, there are so many different tyrannies here. It has made this job very difficult. So I'll give you an example from my own reporting life. In 2020, when I was for 60 days obsessed with the story of India's migrant workers who were walking our highways and leaving the cities to go to their villages, I know that one of the big challenges was that the profile of my audience was not from that class, right? I was talking essentially to elite people who this was not their tragedy. They were more obsessed with, am I going to get COVID? Am I not going to get COVID? Yet I knew that I couldn't lecture them or I couldn't guilt them into caring. So I had to fall back on the old-fashioned tool of journalism, which is a story well told. Yeah. And eventually I succeeded. But I know that if I were very caught in how many views, how much advertising in a bigger organization, I would have had to give it up.
No, I think it's a vicious cycle, according to me. For example, there are days when we would be worried about nobody's reading a story or nobody's watching a video. And then we sort of end up doing things which we think people will read or watch. I mean, but I've realized that over the last few years, I've realized that, look, there are two things in front of me. One, as an entrepreneur, I have to keep a website going. And for that, I do certain things. Am I happy about it, proud about it? I don't know. But I do those small, small things. But as a journalist, telling those stories which matter to me, matter to the audience, that is a much more bigger task in front of me. So my 90% dedication is towards that. And the 10% which can, like, for example, yesterday we put out a story saying 4 farmhouses that you can visit if you live in Bangalore, right? People read that the most because your Google algorithm throws that up. It takes us 10 minutes to write it. But so the point is we do certain things to keep a site going. But eventually I want to depend less and less and less on this advertising model. There is no, otherwise we just get caught in the cycle again and again.
But I want to jump in because we're getting the first of our comments and I prefer to take audience conversations in the middle of the conversation. So please, for the audience, keep them coming. Nikhil says a renewal of the social contract between journalism and society may be required. What could this social contract be and how can it be achieved? And Dhanya, here's my point to you. I agree. We all have to do things. Those of us who've now become independent entrepreneurs, we have small media startups. We are not backed by big corporate houses. In the end, other than some advertising, our revenue has to come either from partnerships or from the audience. Now, one of the things I find contradictory is that people complain nonstop about the quality of journalism, but very few are willing to pay anything for it.
No, exactly. I mean, whenever any session I attend and people are like, you are sensationalizing, journalists are not reporting what is important. I keep telling them that if I write a story about a manual scavenger, for example, last week, 2 manual scavengers died in Hyderabad. It's a city which boasts of having jet sewer machines. One man's body was not recovered for 3 days. Both of them are Dalits. We wrote all this repeatedly. I know how many people will read that story. I also know how many people will read a story if I say that some tech company in Bangalore, the water supply stopped for a day. So, you know, the hypocrisy of the audience also has to be called out. But that does not mean that I stop doing my work. I will continue to write about that Dalit man in Hyderabad. And over the years, I've realized that journalism that we do cannot be driven by echo chambers on social media. Neither can it be driven by what our revenue models say. And on that point, so there are 2 things in front of us, right? One is that more people with money have to support media ventures, especially in the current political social atmosphere in India.
It is precisely in this environment that big money is too petrified to back media. And therefore, by the way, we are more than ever dependent on our audience.
Exactly. I mean, all of us are asking for subscribers, membership, yeah, in the audience. And the audience keep asking us, are you guys not getting money otherwise? We are not. Because most people, there are other than 1 or 2 organizations, which are foundations, basically, which are helping all of us. Most people want to keep away from media because it has become problematic. It is risky. But I'm saying this is a time when you should put money in the media, because the time when we need more people to speak up, speak truth to the power. And also, I believe that business people in this country have to realize that media is not a scalable property as a tech company is. For example, you don't put money in the media because you immediately expect money back, which is another reason which puts me off. Everyone is like, what is your unique audience? how many people keep clicking your story. That does not matter. The point is in cultivating an interested, a nuanced audience and to keep growing on that.
I like to say that Indian media has seen three phases of control. The first phase was the state, when you had no private, at least television media. So you had, Doordarshan and so on. So it was what I call the tyranny of the state. Television was the tyranny of the market. You know, we started off with these sort of very romantic ideas of a Chinese wall between your advertiser and your content. But at the end of it, if you could get neither TRPs, which is television rating points, nor sponsors, your program was eased out. And that's actually the truth for so many channels. And now we're in the tyranny of the algorithm, where you have these big giant tech companies basically deciding what is your keyword. People will keep putting those keywords into their headlines just so that somebody clicks. And then we go into conversations like this, where everybody will crib nonstop about the quality of journalism. Neera ji, aapne jab patrakar banne ka faisla liya, to kyun aapke man mein kya tha ki aap patrakar bani? Kyunki hamare shehron mein aajkal bahut se jo bacche hain jo padhai karke patrakar banna chahte hain, unko lagta hai wo famous ho jayenge, unka shakal camera pe aa jayega, unko khoob paise milenge. Aur main hamesha kehti hu ki sabse galat reason hai ye. This is the wrongest reason to become a journalist. Lekin एक जमाना था जब मैवरिक लोग जो थोड़े हटके लोग थे वो पत्रकार बनते थे. अब हमारी पत्रकारिता भी थोड़ी जैसे कहते ना नॉर्मल चीज हो गई है. तो वो उस तरह के जोश वाले लोग हमेशा मिलते नहीं है. तो जब आप ने फैसला किया पत्रकार बनने का, तो आपकी क्या उम्र थी और आपके माइंड में उस समय क्या थॉट था कि मैं क्यों जर्नलिस्ट बनना चाहती
हूँ? मुझे लगता है मुझे सिर्फ जॉब की ज़रूरत थी. मैंने ऐसे कोई प्लानिंग नहीं करी थी कि मुझे पत्रकार बनना है. मैं उस समय पढ़ाई कर रही थी, मेरा ग्रेजुएशन चल रहा था, ग्रेजुएशन का दूसरा साल था, और मुझे बहुत तेज़ी से ज़रूरत थी मनी की, पैसे की, अपनी पढ़ाई को पूरी करने के लिए. तब मुझे पता चला था कि खबर लहरिया में जगह है, भर्तियां चल रहे हैं, तो वहां पर मैंने एप्लीकेशन डाला और मेरा सिलेक्शन हो गया. शायद इसलिए जब पहली बारी मुझे मेरा टेस्ट हुआ, तो उसमें ये कहा गया कि अपने जो आसपास की चीज़ें हैं उस पर आपको एक ड्राफ्ट लिखना है 500 वर्ड का, और मैंने उसको लिख करके दे दिया. शायद बस इसी के बाद से मेरा सिलेक्शन हो गया. मुझे ये अंदाजा नहीं था.
आपने किस पे ड्राफ्ट लिखा?
नाली नहीं है, खड़ंजे नहीं है, लोगों की सुनवाई नहीं हो रही है, प्रधान कोई ध्यान नहीं दे रहा है. तो खैर, मैंने ऐसे कुछ फोकस करके नहीं लिखा कि मुझे सिर्फ अगर लिखना है बिजली के बारे में लिखना है तो मैंने बिजली के बारे में लिख दिया. ऐसे नहीं, मेरे आसपास जो भी चीजें थी, मुझे जितना भी पता था, वो मैंने लिख कर दे दिया. बस इसके बाद फिर मेरा सिलेक्शन हो गया. मेरी जो चॉइस थी, जो मेरा चॉइस विषय हमेशा से रहा है, वो सब्जेक्ट जो रहा है वो पॉलिटिक्स साइंस था. तो शायद पता नहीं, शायद यही मेरा एक चॉइस अच्छा रह गया हो, इसलिए मैं आगे चल करके फिर मैं कंटिन्यू फिर मैं वहीं पर काम करती रह गई और आज तक मैं खबर लहरिया में हूँ.
तो कितना साल हो गया आपको?
14 साल हो रहे हैं मेरे को, 14 साल.
ओके, ग्रेट. बहुत से सवाल आ रहे हैं, लॉट्स ऑफ क्वेश्चंस आर कमिंग इन, एंड आई एम गोइंग टू टेक देम अलोंगसाइड. धन्या सोनाली सेज, हाउ कैन सिटीजंस नो मिस इन्फॉर्मेशन फ्रॉम ट्रूथ एंड फैक्ट्स फ्रॉम ओपिनियन? नाउ ओपिनियन एंड फैक्ट्स हैव गॉट ब्लर्ड. And by the way, while we may want to blame right-wing media for this, I actually find liberal left-wing media just as opinionated and often reporting also through an ideological prism. So my question is for you, Dhanya. There are stories that don't have another side. And there are those. Let's not pretend. But there are those, there are many shades of complexity that are establishing that truth. How ideological are you comfortable being with your journalism?
See, first thing, I have never believed that journalists can be neutral, unbiased, etc. Because from choosing the story that you want to do on a day, your bias plays out from there. In front of me, there are three things to do on a particular day. I think this story deserves more importance. My bias plays there. So I've never believed that journalists are unbiased, or they can be in the way they tell a story. For example, we have been told, okay, bring all sides. But as you said, there are some stories which don't have another side, or perhaps the other side should not, you know, there's no point giving both sides the equal importance. To Sonali's questions of how can citizens understand misinformation, I mean, citizens have to cultivate that discipline of understanding. I mean, there's no other way to really help, right? For example, when the story about Pegasus breaks, you understand that the first initial stories are about the facts that Pegasus spyware is being used and that this many phones have been hacked, etc. The next round of stories are opinions, where people are saying, why have governments done this? Why are governments keeping quiet? So we as audience have to also start understanding that there is this much fact in a story, there is this much opinion. And sometimes there are certain organizations which do blur. For example, in the News Minutes case, I know very well that when it's cases to do with women, we are highly opinionated even in our news copies.
Yeah. So there's a follow-up. I mean, it's kind of linked question from Pooja, who says the separation between news reportage and all other content, including op-eds, is becoming increasingly difficult because it's all online, it's all digital, it's all using social media. And I think this is a great question because the newspaper had a separation, and the best newspapers in the world still do, between the news pages and the opinion pages. But when content is at the same place, which is basically tweeted out links or links on Facebook that somebody may or may not click on, then that line actually is totally blurred today. Main meera aap se puchna chahungi ki jo sawal uth rahe hain ki kisi ki raay, jaise ki kisi ki opinion, kisi ki soch aur kisi ki reporting, इसमें कितना ओवरलैप होता है? आप कितनी बारी ऐसी सिचुएशंस में अपने आप को पाती हैं कि आपकी सोच कुछ और है लेकिन आपको ग्राउंड पे फैक्ट्स कुछ और बता रहे हैं?
हाँ, बहुत बहुत इसमें फर्क होता है, जो हम जिस तरह से सोचते हैं और जिस तरह से हमने सुन रखा है, जिस तरह से, अगर हम खासकर बात करें सरकारी योजनाओं के बारे में, अगर मैं बात करूं उनका क्या मतलब, उसके पीछे की क्या उद्देश्य है और इन सब चीजों को लेकर के जब हम वहां पे जा रहे हैं, खैर अपनी सोच को लेकर के मैं यहाँ पे बात करना चाहूंगी कि जो हम जिस तरह से सोचते हैं उधर होता नहीं है, उस तरह से लोग उस तरह से देखते नहीं है, और हम जिस चीज को निकालना चाहते हैं, जिस तरह से निकालना चाहते हैं, जिस तरह से लोगों से बातचीत करना चाहते हैं, वो तो जब हम उस स्टोरी को प्रोड्यूस करते हैं, मतलब कि उसको प्रोडक्शन के बाद जो वो चीजें निकल के आती हैं, वो बाद में समझ में आता है। लेकिन हाँ, इसमें बहुत फर्क होता है कि वहां पे और यहाँ पे, मतलब हमारी सोच पे और वहां पे बहुत फर्क है।
आपके लिए एक और सवाल है सहाना से, जो कहती है, ग्रास रूट्स मीडिया इज इंटेंडेड टू प्रोवाइड अ नेशनल प्लेटफॉर्म फॉर सिटीजंस फ्रॉम रूरल एरियाज एंड नॉन मेट्रोस टू हैव अ वॉइस, इज दैट एक्चुअली हैपनिंग? आप क्या देखते हैं कि आपकी रिपोर्टाज से जो मुद्दे हैं, एक लोकल इश्यू को नेशनल इश्यू बनाना कितना मुश्किल रहता है? और ये एक बहुत मुश्किल चीज है किसी को एक्सप्लेन करना, और मैं 25 साल बाद भी एक्सप्लेन नहीं कर पाती कि क्यों हो सकता है एक बलात्कार या एक मर्डर या एक करप्शन केस एक नेशनल स्टोरी बन जाता है, और वही सेट ऑफ फैक्ट्स in another case वो नहीं बनती national headline. तो आपने अपने experience में क्या देखा है कि how often आपकी कोई local story हो वो एक बड़ा मुद्दा nationally बन जाता है?
एक छोटा सा example दूंगी कि जब हमारी story channel पर चलती है और जब हम ऐसी story coverage करते हैं जो रेप, मर्डर और ये सब, मतलब जो भी क्रिमिनल की स्टोरी होती है, वो एक छोटी सी भी स्टोरी हो, एक मिनट की भी स्टोरी, तो मतलब उसका इतना व्यूज होगा, इतना ज़्यादा चलेगा। लेकिन वहीं पे अगर कोई एक बहुत बड़ी स्टोरी है, गहराई से सर्च वाली स्टोरी है, उस स्टोरी में उतना व्यूज नहीं मिलता है। तो मेरे ख्याल से आप समझ गए होंगे कि मतलब कितना फर्क है कि एक ऐसे मुद्दे को जो बहुत नीचे है, जो जिसको हम पाताल कर सकते हैं वहां पर है, और उसको निकालने में और ऊपर तक लाने में कितनी ज्यादा मुश्किलें हैं। सही आप कह रहे हैं कि इसका जवाब दे पाना बहुत मुश्किल है। जब बड़ी बड़ी रैलियां होती हैं यहाँ पर, लोग वहां से निकल कर के आते हैं, जब तक मतलब एक घटना नहीं होती, मान लीजिए कोई सड़क खराब है, क्योंकि मैं उस तरह से रिपोर्टिंग करती हूँ, तो शायद उस तरह मैं सोचती भी हूँ कि कोई सड़क खराब है, कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं, रोज लोग निकल रहे हैं, उनको दिक्कतें हो रही हैं, सब कुछ हो रहा है, उस पे कोई रिपोर्टिंग नहीं है, उसकी कोई चर्चा नहीं, लेकिन अगर वहां पे एक्सीडेंट हो जाए तो वही एक खबर बन जाती है और वो वायरल हो जाती है।
तो ये तो हर जर्नलिस्ट का चैलेंज है कि ये मीरा जी, ये आपके लिए भी सच है, ये धन्या के लिए भी सच है और ये मेरे लिए भी सच है कि मैं अगर कहूंगी अपनी हेडलाइन में कि, and by the way, I do think it's a valid story that Kareena Kapoor is targeted for what she named her son, क्योंकि मुझे लगता है कि उसमें anti-woman sentiment भी है, anti-Muslim sentiment भी है, इसलिए I think it's a valid statement. लेकिन मैं ये भी जानती हूँ कि क्योंकि हेडलाइन में Kareena Kapoor है, वही मुद्दा ज्यादा कंज्यूम होगा। और अगर मैं अनमोल प्रीतम की बात करूं, जो कि एक पत्रकार थे जिनको दबाव में वो आए एक एंटी मुस्लिम रैली पर, तो वो उतने क्लिक्स नहीं आएंगे। सो दिस रिमेन्स चैलेंजेस फॉर ऑल ऑफ अस। देयर इज अ नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम संजय हजारिका, हाउ डू यू इंश्योर दैट फैक्ट चेकिंग, दैट इज रोबस्ट रिसर्च, बिकम्स नॉर्मल फॉर मीडिया प्रोफेशनल्स, स्पेशली एट अ टाइम व्हेन दे गेट लेसर टाइम टू राइट और प्रिपेयर फॉर ब्रॉडकास्ट। इट्स अ ग्रेट क्वेश्चन। एंड यू नो, one is of course that we don't have time because we're doing this, we're on this daily treadmill, Dhanya, but the other is that this is where revenue matters. I personally think that the decline of television news, and I say this is a child of television, now still in visual storytelling but on digital, began because the revenue model was broken, because it didn't have money to sustain either ground reporting or researchers or travel or depth. So while we want to be dismissive about revenue directly impacts the quality of work that we're able to do.
Oh, of course, that does. But coming to Sanjay's question itself, how do you ensure fact-checking? Like Barkha was saying, that there's one, whether the organization has time, money, resources to ensure that its journalists can do all that. That they have, like, if I want a journalist to write a story today, am I giving that person enough time to do research? But I also believe it's a discipline that organizations have to inculcate, have to cultivate, and there is absolutely no excuse for it. But Sanjay, if I can just say something, that, you know, fact-checking and research is very important, of course, and that discipline has to be there in organizations. But what I've realized after working for national media for 8 years and then running my own organization for 7 years is that other than fact-checking, what really needs to be told to journalists, to be taught to journalists, is nuances, is understanding a story. For example, when I was in Times Now, I used to report things like Tamil Nadu is giving freebies all the time. Or I used to look down upon Karunanidhi's announcement for color televisions. I was also told that, that blackening the English boards on the metro in Bangalore was just some rogue Kannada activist. But today I do understand the nuance that it is not people who are against English or Hindi, but they are against the imposition of a language. I understand where the Dravidian model of social justice comes, which also includes what we dismiss as freebies. So I think it's not just about fact-checking and robust research. It's also about perspectives. And I believe that that's, again, a discipline which organizations have to cultivate, which editors have to cultivate in their organizations.
And I'll give a simpler example, because I'm often working at these impossible deadlines where sometimes even when I'm doing something, I find that my research is cosmetic. And I have learned to forgive myself for that. I have learned to accept that I cannot know everything about everything. Right? It's not possible for any human being, either as an editor or as a journalist, to know in-depth information about everything. So there are certain things that you will know better. I will always know Jammu and Kashmir, India, Pakistan better because I spent 20 years reporting it, compared to Tamil Nadu and the DMK's history, which I know next to nothing about. But I may still have to report the Tamil Nadu election for whatever reasons, right? For the reason that I'm a small startup, I don't have reporters in every bureau, or because I've been assigned that story. It could be any reason. Now, one is that you have to do your basic reading. But I always say that when you don't know, don't pretend to know. Like, there are small ways in which you can be honest with your audience. So sometimes when I don't know something, I will say in my question, you know, I know very little about this, to whoever I'm talking to on camera, I don't know. Can you tell me? I know very little. I know only what I've read on Google. It's okay. I think as long as you're honest with your audience, nobody thinks you're a walking encyclopedia that you can know everything. Of course, they will appreciate if you made the effort to research. That's one point. The second point is one old journalistic rule of attribution. somehow we are seeing an entire generation of journalists growing up without attribution. And by attribution, I simply mean, you know, we disparage he said, she said journalism. Actually, it's a very important thing because sometimes you are reporting an unfolding series of events. So, for example, in Kanpur, we saw that a Muslim man and his daughter on video were beaten, roughed up and forced to say Jai Shri Ram while the little girl cried. Now, this video comes to you. You want to report it instantly, but you are not in a position to talk to that man. You're not in a position to talk to him. Not immediately. But you want to report, you will first have to give the source of the video. You can't say on the internet I found this video. You have to be able to attribute it to so and so person. You have to make the effort to see has the UP police responded to it, right? Then you follow up. So today, for example, we have sent a reporter to Kanpur, right, to meet that family. So it's a layered reporting, and I just think it's a thing of discipline. Meera, isme aap kya bolengi ki मैं ये बोल रही हूँ कि हम भी इंसान हैं, हमें हर मुद्दे के बारे में सब कुछ नहीं मालूम. ऐसे बहुत से मुद्दे होंगे जिसके बारे में हमें इतना ज्यादा नहीं मालूम. जब हम वो मुद्दे रिपोर्ट करते हैं तो हमें क्या करना चाहिए?
मुझे लगता है कि ऐसी रिपोर्टिंग के लिए बहुत बारी हम गूगल सर्च इंटरनेट पर जानकारी इकट्ठा करते हैं, तब जाकर के उन पर रिपोर्टिंग करना, या फिर जो इसके लिए जिम्मेदार है, कोई विभाग है, कोई और भी संबंधित जिम्मेदार व्यक्ति हैं, वहां से जाकर के उन जानकारियों को इकट्ठा करके और फिर उस पर रिपोर्टिंग करना. लेकिन कई बार ऐसे भी होता है कि मन में बहुत सारे सवाल होते हैं, कितना भी सर्च करें, गूगल सर्च करें या कहीं से भी जानकारी ले लें, लेकिन जब पूरी तरह से हमें तसल्ली नहीं होती है कि क्योंकि सिर्फ जानकारी बस की बात नहीं है, उस पर किस तरह से करना है, क्या एंगल है, किस सोच के साथ उसको किस तरह से पेश करना है, ये सारी चीजें भी जुड़ती हैं. तो बहुत सारी चीजें, मतलब सर्च के अलग अलग हिस्से हो सकते हैं, वहां से जाकर के हम ये सारी मटेरियल इकट्ठा करके फिर रिपोर्टिंग की तरफ बढ़ते हैं.
नहीं, बिल्कुल, जैसे धन्या ने न्यूएंस की बात की, एक्चुअली रियल स्किल इज कि आप स्टोरी टेलर, आप कुछ भी मुद्दे, कुछ भी फैक्ट्स रखे, टू बी जर्नलिस्ट यू हैव टू इफेक्टिवली टेल अ स्टोरी. एचआर वेंकटेश हैज अ क्वेश्चन एंड आई फाउंड दिस बाय द वे इन द चैट बॉक्स, सो आई डोंट नो, आई वांट टू लुक फॉर द क्वेश्चंस इन द Q&A. प्लीज पुट योर क्वेश्चंस इन द Q&A कॉलम. इज देयर एन एपेटाइट टू कंज्यूम 1,000 खबर लहरियाज across India? Dhanya, what do you think? As local becomes the future, and there is, and you know, many big media houses experimented with this 10 years ago, maybe trying to have local streams to their TV channels, etc., but they didn't work oddly enough, right? Now, in this digital age where everything is at the same place, which is a click of a button, how do you make stories that are both local and universal? How do you find and tell those stories?
No, I definitely think, Venkatesh, that India definitely is an appetite to consume 1,000 khabar lehriyas, and India needs 1,000 khabar lehriyas for two different things. One is that when you have local news outfits which are covering local stories, like for example, the News Minute covers only South India, but that's still too large a space. Like for example, if I was covering only Kerala or I was covering only Tamil Nadu, and in that one district or one city, I have more sustained interest in that city or in that state, and my coverage becomes more in-depth. So I definitely believe that the audience is ready for it, but our revenue models are not ready for it, because there is no, I mean, I have seen people running regional websites which do amazing content, really struggling, because for a long time, Google was not giving any ads in regional languages. They just opened up a few years ago. Yeah. And people who have money in those places don't realize the importance of local media. But I also believe at the same time, Venkatesh, that while local media has to grow, and that's extremely important, we should not lose sight of the national media. See, for example, when a flood happens in Kerala or Chennai, for example, the media there covers it. They tell the audience exactly what is happening, who are you supposed to call, etc. But you still need that Delhi media to amplify that story to people sitting in Delhi, especially the politicians. Sadly, our governance is from Delhi. So that amplification has to happen. So I think both the national media and the local media have to exist, have to sync well. Only then will our media be more powerful.
But I do, if I can just add a sentence there, I do think that the best reporting will appeal to both audiences. So the challenge becomes to find a way to tell a story that, irrespective of its geographical context, there's something universal about it. And my thumb rule, I mean, at least what I've told colleagues, and I apply that rule to myself, is that a good story has to do one of the following four things. It has to either increase someone's learning, or it has to trigger an emotion. And that emotion can be a sense of rage, a sense of hope, or a sense of affinity. And I just find that, you know, if you can't tap into the emotional quotient of your audience, chances are, no matter how attached you personally are to the telling of that story, it will sink without a trace. So there are also tools of storytelling, and we must not forget ki hum badlav chahte hain meera ji, lekin kahani bhi achhi honi chahiye. Main ye bol rahi hu. Aur Natasha ka, sorry Dhanya, go ahead.
I just want to add something. I agree with your point that the art of storytelling is also very important for a story. But my issue here is that even if we are the best storytellers, for example, the interview that you did recently with the child who lost her parents, but in her exam, she performed really well, right? You are someone who has more than 7 million followers on Twitter. So you have a platform. But what I'm saying is that the algorithm-driven news atmosphere is so skewed that someone else, somewhere else doing the same story may not get the traction, though they may have said. So the problem is we are all stuck in a situation.
I agree with you. I agree that sometimes it's the algorithm, sometimes it's personality, sometimes it's I don't know, the way you do the same story. There are many different reasons and all could be true, including the algorithm. And I completely agree with that point. Meera ji, aapke liye ye Natasha ka sawal hai, Natasha Joshi. Question for Meera ji. Do communities trust local grassroots more compared with national or mainstream media? Aapne kya discover kiya hai ki ek jo trust hota hai citizen ka, wo local mein zyada hai? कि अभी भी लोगों को लगता है कि अरे बड़े शहर से बड़े अखबार वाले आएंगे या बड़े चैनल वाले आएंगे तो हम उनको ज्यादा मानते हैं।
हाँ, अगर मैं जहां पर हम काम कर रहे हैं, जहां पर हम स्थापित हैं, वहां पर तो मैंने बहुत लोगों को सुना है कि अगर कोई है जिसमें ट्रस्ट है, भरोसा है, निष्पक्षता है, तो वो है खबर लहरिया। और सिर्फ लोगों तक नहीं, ये प्रशासन के लोग भी बोलते हैं, और उनको कहीं ना कहीं तो ये बात लग रही है कि ये बात वो क्यों बोल रहे हैं, कहीं ना कहीं तो उनको इस पर भरोसा है। एक चीज थोड़ा सा मैं और जोड़ना चाहूंगी, यहाँ पर बात आई है कि अच्छी स्टोरी होना चाहिए। उस पर अगर मैं सवाल करूं कि अच्छी स्टोरी क्या होती है,
मैं जवाब दूंगी इसका, मैं आपको जवाब दूंगी। अगर मैं, मतलब मुझे ये फैसले अपने लिए भी नहीं, अपने जैसे जिन लोगों के साथ मैं काम करती हूँ उनके लिए भी लेने पड़ते हैं। और कई बार मैं कहती हूँ ये मुद्दा इंपॉर्टेंट है लेकिन ये स्टोरी बोरिंग है। नाउ व्हाट आई मीन बाय दैट इज कि उसको जिस तरह से पेश किया जाता है, जैसे कि मैं हमेशा कहती हूँ कि अगर आप मेरे को एक स्टेटिस्टिक देंगे कि भारत में सिर्फ 11% लोगों को कंप्यूटिंग डिवाइस का एक्सेस है, ओनली 11% इंडियंस हैव एक्सेस टू कंप्यूटिंग डिवाइस, अगर आप मेरे को ये डेटा देंगे, ये डेटा बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट डेटा है क्योंकि हमारे स्कूल बंद रहे हैं 500 दिन, लेकिन अगर आप मुझे एक 10 साल की बच्ची से मिलाएंगे जिसका सपना था पुलिस ऑफिसर बनना और वो स्कूल नहीं जा पाई और उसको लगता है कि 2 साल उसके निकल गए, तो वो जो आंकड़ा है उसका कमिंग अलाइव उस लड़की की कहानी से होता है। तो हम, मेरी अपनी सोच ये है कि हम कोई भी बड़ा मुद्दा रखना चाहे तो हमें छोटे तरीके ढूंढने चाहिए उसकी स्टोरी प्रेजेंट करने की।
या कंप्लीटली,
आप सहमत है मीरा जी?
हाँ, लेकिन बहुत सारे ऐसे लोग बोलते हैं ना कि वो अच्छी स्टोरी नहीं थी, तो मैं सोचती हूँ कि फिर उनके मन में ऐसी बातें कि वो शायद मैंने ऐसे जिस तरह से आपने सोचा उस तरह से मैंने सोच के ये सवाल नहीं किया। वो तो एक रिपोर्टिंग का है कि हम किस तरह से उसको मतलब प्रस्तुत कर रहे हैं। मेरा सवाल ऐसे है कि बहुत लोग ऐसे सोचते हैं कि ये स्टोरी अच्छी है, ये स्टोरी नहीं अच्छी है, तो स्टोरी कौन सी नहीं अच्छी है, कौन सी अच्छी है, वहां पर मेरा सवाल है।
ये आपका अच्छा सवाल है, मैं धन्या से पूछूंगी। धन्या, देयर आर सर्टेन थिंग्स लाइक एज यू सेड दैट वी डू फॉर रेवेन्यू, there are certain things we do for audience, and there are certain things we do because we genuinely believe that they are important. And I actually think that if we're truthful, we all do a mix of all of these three things every day.
Of course, I mean, I am not denying that at all. In fact, when I was in television, for example, one of my friends, she became an entertainment reporter. We studied in college together. Recently, she told me that, do you remember you used to look down upon entertainment reporters and say, I report politics, what do you do? But lately, I have realized that not the fact that pop culture, cinema, the influence that it has on people, that we need to have more dialogues on what happens there. So what I have realized in the last few years is that there are certain things that you do for clicks, for revenue or whatever, but there are intelligent ways in which you can, you know, sort of make sure that that also aligns with what you think, your ideology, what you believe in.
Yeah. Okay. There are a bunch of very interesting questions. I think Nikhil has another question on the sort of TLDR phenomenon. I mean, that's my phrase, not his. The larger public has moved to a shorter, less thinking content consumption. Quality journalism still relies heavily on long articles, reportage, etc. Is there a need to move to newer ways of communicating? And is there a barrier to make that jump? Dhanya, do you want to take that?
No, see, I understand that a lot of people go to InShots and Daily Hunt. Like when we get these alerts from InShots, I'm shocked. I'm like, so many people are on InShots all the time. But do I want to be encouraging these people to be on InShots all the time? No. I will still, I mean, today, just now we have published a story. It is 3,000 words. It's about a top police officer in Tamil Nadu who was accused of sexual harassment. 3,000 words. I don't know how many people read it. But the point is, you have to keep it. There is no way that you can shorten that to 50 words just because some people will not read 3,000 words. I mean, Korean pop became popular, right? Does that mean that we stop all other kinds of music and we just do Korean pop? We cannot.
I'll give a slightly different answer. I agree with Dhanya, but I also think that we all have to learn different kinds of storytelling. So for me, for example, I have to keep telling myself, this is how you would have told the story in TV. You have to find a different way of telling the story. People are watching it on their phone. So we also have to remember the end consumption device. You see, you're not, people aren't curling up with a book. They're not sipping their morning chai and reading their newspaper at leisure. We have become content that is consumed where people commute, while they're going home, while they're doing something else. Unka dhyan aada hi hai. So it is a challenge, but I agree with Dhanya that you have to have a mix.
No, I have no problem with learning and doing new things. There are so many. I don't understand. I understand Instagram Reel and all that stuff, but we are made to do all that. All that is fine. Learning and doing new things is fine. But simply because we believe the audience will read 100 words to actually shorten things which require to be told in detail, I am not for that.
मीरा जी, आपकी भी ट्रेनिंग में क्या आपको बोला था कि छोटी छोटी रखिए कहानियां, क्योंकि लोग पढ़ते नहीं लंबी लंबी या देखते नहीं है लंबी लंबी कहानियां?
हाँ, ऐसे होता है कि ऐसी स्टोरियां जो जिसको बड़ा कर सकते हैं, जिसको छोटा कर सकते हैं, वो सारी चीजें सिखाई जाती हैं और सिखाया गया है, हमें भी बताया गया है
कि कुछ छोटी और कुछ बड़ी, लेंथ विल डिपेंड ऑन द स्टोरी. ओके, संजय हैज अनदर क्वेश्चन. वन ऑफ द की चैलेंजेस टुडे इज द मेंटल वेलबींग ऑफ जर्नलिस्ट बिकॉज ऑफ स्ट्रेस, टॉक्सिक बिहेवियर. यू नो, दिस इज क्रिटिकल फॉर बेटर रिपोर्टिंग दैट द मीडिया कम्स टुगेदर. संजय, आई हेट टू ब्रेक दिस टू यू, बट अकॉर्डिंग टू मी, आई डोंट नो धन्या विल अग्री, आई थिंक द मीडिया इज कंप्लीटली डिवाइडेड, कंप्लीटली बिटर, कंप्लीटली, I mean, I find the Indian media has not shown a point of unity on literally any single issue for as long as I can remember. I don't know if you'll agree, Dhanya.
Well, I don't. First thing, I don't expect the entire Indian media to come and support. So I understand what Barkha is saying, that most times people cannot agree who to support, even to give a press release, whether we should give for this person or that person. But as organizations, I think we can all do a lot. For example, we are all social media all the time. And the kind of stuff which comes on social media, initially, I used to get very disturbed. I used to lose my sleep. I used to have nightmares. But I slowly realized there are ways to cope with it. And now I tell people who join my organization that this much seriously only you will take feedback from anonymous people on the internet. If people abuse you, please use mute, block, etc. So I think those kind of conversations have to keep going in organizations. Otherwise, it is very difficult, especially for young people. If they go wrong on a story, or if they take a point of, like, for example, 2 weeks ago, a reporter of mine was being very badly told for for speaking up about a man who died in an accident. He was a Dalit man who died in an accident, but he was a very controversial figure in Telugu states. So this report of mine spoke up for that man, and he was attacked for days, like 2 or 3 days, and he was getting disturbed. So I told him, it's fine, just stay away, don't look at it. So I think we need to have these conversations all the time, because it does impact a lot of young journalists. And the danger of this, Sanjay, is that they start self-censoring.
And there's also another danger, which is that I truly believe that while popularity is good, a journalist should not be seeking it. And what happens with this Twitter type forums is that sometimes even if you get lovely responses, oh, great, you'll start thinking, okay, when I say this, I get great. When I report this, I get great. And you will hesitate to report anything which gets you a slight pushback. And so these are very, very difficult times, because there's no escaping social media, not until the audience, you know, I will keep saying there's a direct engagement. The quality of media, the audience has a direct input in where we go from here. And frankly, I don't think a lot of us would want to spend hours on Twitter if we could ensure that there was some other way that you came directly to our websites or our platforms. We use it as a tool of broadcasting, and that's why we're there. And I think we've all learned the hard way to mute and block and not engage. And really, there is nothing more wasteful than having an argument with someone on Twitter. There is a couple of more questions. We're almost at the end. Pooja has a question for Meera. Did the Hathras case reporting caste-based gender violence, it became a national conversation on the local national connect point? Could Meera share more? Meera, is pe aap kya bolna chahenge ki jaise humne Hathras mein dekha ki wo ek bahut bada mudda ho gaya, lekin hamare gaon mein to roz hi aise mudde hote hain. तो ये लोकल को नेशनल बनाना, इसका क्या एक्सपीरियंस आपके आपके एक्सपीरियंस में क्या क्या आपने कौन सी स्टोरीज हैं जो नेशनल अटेंशन गार्नर करती है?
बिल्कुल सही कह रहे हैं पूजा, आपकी बात से मैं बिल्कुल सहमत हूँ कि जिस तरह का केस वहां पर हुआ था हाथरस में, और उसके बाद भी तुरंत उसी गांव में वहीं पर फिर से एक केस आया, और अभी हाल में ही दिल्ली में भी ऐसा केस आया है। तो और अगर हम बुंदेलखंड की बात करें, अगर हम ग्रामीण भारत की बात करें, अगर हम जहां पर ऐसे लोग रह रहे हैं जो हाशिए पर हैं, ऐसे लोग हैं, तो वहां पर इस तरह की घटनाएं रोज होती हैं, लेकिन उनको इतना बड़ा मुद्दा नहीं बन पाता है या बनाया नहीं जाता है, या उसको उतनी जगह नहीं मिलती है जिस तरह से एक बड़ा मुद्दा बन सके, जैसे हाथरस वाला केस है। तो इसके पीछे मतलब कितना मीडिया को किस तरह से लगना पड़ा है, किस तरह से सवाल उठाने पड़े हैं, मतलब हर तरह से अपने को सामने रख करके इस मुद्दे को उठाना पड़ा है। उसको हर तरह से कवरेज किया गया है, पुलिस की स्थिति, उनके गांव की स्थिति, उसके घर की स्थिति, और उसका बैकग्राउंड क्या है, और वहां पर जिस तरह से वहां पे हो रहा था उसको भी, जो आरोपी पक्ष था उसका जिस तरह का रोल था, उन सब में जब एक तरह से मीडिया की बाढ़ आ गई थी, पूरे देश का मीडिया जिस हाथरस को कभी सुना भी नहीं था वो देश का मीडिया वहां पर मौजूद था, जब इस तरह से मुद्दे खबर होते हैं तब मुझे लगता है तभी जाकर के इस तरह के मुद्दे वो बड़े मुद्दे बनते हैं और वो नेशनल इंटरनेशनल तक जाते हैं।
बिल्कुल, एक आखिरी सवाल का समय है सिर्फ, क्वेश्चन टू ऑल थ्री, व्हाट गिव्स यू होप फॉर इंडियाज फ्यूचर? धन्या, आई विल स्टार्ट विद यू। यू नो दीज आर ब्लीक टाइम्स इन मेनी वेज, what keeps you going?
Truthfully speaking, my two cats and my dog. But no, seriously, but see, for every 10 people who are abusing us or who are telling us that what you're doing is wrong, there are two or three people who do speak up, who, I mean, and you know, this whole conversation is also about so many of you who work towards betterment of cities, of states, of the country. So there are a lot of people who are invested in the country. They you know, at various levels, they want to make change, they want to initiate change. And I believe the media is just one part of it. All us journalists are just one part of that. So it's that group which gives me gives me hope. Of course, sometimes I feel like, are we stagnating as that group? How long will these same people keep, asking for the same things or demanding for the same things? But I believe that slowly it will grow. For example, I believe the COVID-19 coverage by the media has definitely shaped a lot of thought. For example, there has been a concerted effort to discredit media, not only in India, in US, in many countries, right? Which is led by politicians, especially the government in India, to discredit the media. But the way COVID was covered, the pandemic was covered, especially what happened in Delhi, and when people are suffering, they know that these stories are true, that no matter what the government says, they are the ones who suffered, right? So I think that coverage has definitely changed the outlook which many people had towards the media. While they believe everything was fake news or propaganda, they have slowly realized, no, that not everything is propaganda. There is some truth behind. So I believe sustained coverage, sustained interest will make a lot of people see what we are doing.
Sana has an added question about what are your asks from the social sector or civil society or philanthropists. I think I would speak for everybody if I just said that, you know, you all need to find a way to support media that you believe in. Because the fact is that most startups today, every day or every month or every week, great journalists are spending and wasting a lot of time on just how to remain afloat. And that is the truth of the times that we live in. So if you have mechanisms, and those can be small, you don't have to all put giant money. You can pay the subscription fee, just that for the...
Take a subscription for 10 lakh rupees.
Okay. I was going to be more modest to say pay at least 500 rupees a month. But Dhanya is better at me than asking for money.
Right?
But yes, we all need money. There's no question about that. But I wanted to add to the point about hope, you know. I think there is one of the things I discovered when I was traveling all across India reporting COVID is that the same Twitter, which was so toxic in so many ways for me, suddenly became like this avenue of amazing support. And there were people who must never have spoken up to express an opinion about anything. But suddenly, you know, this is the first wave when there was no public transport and I was going everywhere by road. People were offering homes, people were offering food. Somebody sent me shoes, somebody offered to have my car repaired. Just the extraordinary kindness of absolute strangers. It made me remember that maybe we need a noise filter that filters out the extremes. You know, we end up spending too much time engaging with the extremes. I think a lot of people in India, okay, maybe they don't have, you know, the gumption to speak up on everything, but they're essentially, people are kind, people are generous. And I think I saw a lot of that in these. I mean, one saw a lot of pain, but one also saw a lot of generosity and kindness. Meera ji, aapko last comment dena chahenge ki aapko kya cheez aaj ke mahol mein bhi umeed deti hai?
Mujhe to मैं इस सवाल को अपने से ही देखती हूँ, खुद से, कि मेरा जो आत्मविश्वास है, जो अपने पर भरोसा है, जो अपनी रिपोर्टिंग पर भरोसा है, वही मेरी उम्मीद है, उसी पर मैं भरोसा करती हूँ।
ये बहुत बढ़िया आंसर है, क्योंकि आप I love the fact that you know none of us actually said you know we hope because we believe in ourselves. और ये मेरा आपने हमें याद दिलाया कि हम ही काफी हैं उम्मीद के लिए, हम अकेले ही काफी हैं, आप ये कहना चाह रही हैं?
बिल्कुल.
Wonderful. I think there's no perfect or better note than to end this conversation on. Thank you, Meera. Thank you, Dhanya. Thank you to all of you for having us here and handing it back to Yash.
So much. Thank you. It was lovely. And so
Yash can't hear you.
Am I audible now?
No.
Like a Star Trek zombie.
Yes. Or much worse.
Or much worse.
No, we will end the session for you. Yeah. Thank you everyone for joining.
Yes.
I think the next session, there's no next session, the last session. So please join for the sessions tomorrow.
Thank you. Bye everyone.
Bye. Thank you. Bye.
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 Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye.